Great to see everyone here this morning. Thank you so much for coming and worshiping with us. If you're a guest, give us an opportunity to shake your hand and say hello and welcome you back at any time. If you're a guest and you try to run out here before somebody speaks to you and then you get out and say, they didn't speak to me at all, that's on you. That's not on us. Give us the opportunity to say hello and welcome you back at any time, and we'd love to have you worship God here with us. I read a quote. It says, "Do not have your concert first and tune your instruments afterward. Begin the day with God." Are your hearts in tune with God as we worship Him this morning? Jeremy's going to be leading us in singing. Daniel's going to be reading from Isaiah 52. Roger Minor will lead us in the first prayer. Ryan will help the thoughts before the Lord's Supper. And then Greg will close us out in prayer. Let's all make sure that our hearts are in tune with God as we sing.
Let's all stand for these songs, please. We'll sing 745 first in the fifth, and then we'll go straight into 747. Let's all sing out this morning. Soldiers of Christ, arise and put your armor on. Strong in the strength which God will supply. Strong in the strength which God supplies through His beloved Son. That having all things done and all your conflicts past, you may overcome through Christ alone. You may overcome through Christ alone and stand entire at last. Stand up, stand up.
This morning's scripture reading will come from the book of Isaiah, chapter 52, verses 7 through 9. Isaiah 52, 7 through 9. How beautiful upon the mountains are the feet of him who brings good news, who publishes peace, who brings good news of happiness, who publishes salvation, who says to Zion, "Your God reigns." The voice of your watchmen, they lift up their voice. Together they sing for joy, for eye to eye they see the return of the Lord to Zion. Break forth together into singing, you waste places of Jerusalem, for the Lord has comforted his people, he has redeemed Jerusalem.
Before Roger leads us in prayer, please take the time to read through the bulletin. Look at the names, the members, family, friends. Also, remember that Friday night into Saturday, the storms that went through Arkansas, parts of Tennessee and Kentucky. From what I understand, Joey made the comment this morning, they're saying that as far as Doppler has registered, it seems to be the largest, strongest tornado on record as of right now. I read a little bit about the Mayfield area, and that seems to be the one that they're kind of focusing on because it was kind of took a direct hit. a couple of the Church of Christ there were not damaged. They are out of power. But the disaster relief that we help on a yearly basis were there already. So, of course, we can always do more, but they are there on the ground, and they're making sure that those folks get help. So let's remember those areas, the families affected by those storms, and, of course, the loss of life. It was also mentioned that Johnny and Leslie had a neighbor, Miss Sarah Sides, who's suffering from the effects of a stroke. Let's remember Miss Sarah Sides when we pray. Brenda Moon was a member of the Midway congregation. She's in the nursing home rehab for 21 days. Rhonda Smith, I understand, still in the hospital. Let's remember Miss Rhonda when we pray. Joey said his dad is still doing well after his hip replacement. Let's continue to remember Amanda's dad, Doug Grace, when we pray. And also want to mention that Amber is having some back surgery this week, so let's keep them in our prayers. And, of course, it's not too early to go ahead and mention that coming up, our gospel meeting in February. Let's start praying about that good things come from that. Brother Scott's going to be with us for that February 4th through the 6th. Let's take this time to go to God in prayer.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the day, for the beautiful day that we have to come here this morning and to worship. We thank you for all the blessings that you give us each day, and all of those that you have blessed us with this year. Father, we thank you especially for the answered prayers that we have gotten from those who are sick and those that are having surgery and those who are having procedures. And we ask, just want to thank you for all of those, and we ask your continued blessings on the healing of those that we have of sick of our number. There are so many of those, and we have several that will be undergoing surgery, and we ask that you be with them and be with the doctors that are working with them and help them to do the things that would restore their health. We thank you for all of these blessings that we have an opportunity to go and to be healed, and that we go and to be fed, and that we have all of these things that you have promised, that you are just like the sparrow, that you provide for us. And Father, we just need to continue to remember that all good things come from you, and help us to do that. Father, we ask you to forgive us of our sins. We know that we often fall short, and we need that, and we need to encourage one another, realizing that none of us are without sin, and we all have need of your grace and your mercy. And help us, Father, to show that to one another. Father, we ask your blessings at this time on all of those that's been in the storm, those that have lost loved ones, and those that have had everything taken from them. Father, help us to be of assistance to those folks as we should be. Open doors for us that we have a way of doing things, even if it's remotely, to help those people. And we pray, Father, that you would be with them this Lord's Day and on throughout the week and the coming months that they have to recover from this. Father, we ask you to be with us as we worship here this morning. We pray, Father, that the things that we say and do here this morning will be pleasing to you. And Father, we ask your blessings upon this nation. For we're all in need of you, and we pray, Father, that we would draw closer to you and walk with you, knowing, Father, that you will draw close to us. Be with us on through our services today, on through this week, and on through life. And Father in heaven, save us is our prayer. In your Son, Jesus' name, amen.
Cole, we're going to sing the first, the third, and the fourth of this song to prepare for the Lord's Supper. In Christ alone my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. There in the ground his body lay, light of the world by darkness slain, in bursting form, in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands in victory, since curse has lost his grip on me, for I am his and he is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ. No guilt in life, no fear in death, this is the power of Christ in me. First cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand. Till he returns or calls me home, here in the power of Christ I'll stand.
In the second verse we just sang, the word victory is mentioned. And so this morning I want to take a moment just to read from 1 Corinthians chapter 15, a few verses, make some observations as we at this time gather together as the church and we memorialize Jesus, our Christ, our Savior. Starting in verse 50 of chapter 15, it says, I tell you this, brother, flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does the perishable inherit the imperishable. Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed in a moment, in a twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable, and we shall be changed. For this perishable body must put on the imperishable, and this mortal body must put on the immortal. And this mortal body must put on the immortal. When the perishable puts on the imperishable, and the mortal puts on the immortal, then shall come to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Here we stand and sit together in the flesh, but we're here together worshiping God in the Spirit. An imperishable soul. Our victory is in Christ Jesus. And it came at a cost of his death on the cross. A sacrificial death that he died for the world. And so we spend this time together remembering that. He established that together with his apostles. That Last Supper where he reminded them of the bread that represented his body. And the fruit of the vine that represented his blood for our salvation. And so we have eternal victory in Christ. And so we take that time to remember that this morning, that this world is a perishable thing, that the things that we should set our mind on are above and eternal. And we can thank God through Christ that we have that opportunity. Let's go to God in prayer together. Our Heavenly Father, we are humbled and grateful and thankful that we can approach your throne, that you give us this avenue of prayer through your Son, through your Spirit that you loved us, that you were willing to allow a plan to be in play that we may have eternal life through Jesus. We're thankful for Christ, for his love for us. We're thankful for his obedience to you, that he was willing to sacrifice himself to give his life to defeat sin on our behalf. And through his blood, we have hope of eternal salvation. At this time, we remember his body, the physical, perishable body that was tortured and was beaten in the days of journey and travel that it endured for our sake. We ask, dear Lord, as we partake of this bread that represents that body, that we take it in a manner that pleases you. For it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Let us pray for the fruit of the vine. Our Heavenly Father, we ask your blessings upon this cup, this juice that is representative of the blood of our Savior, your Son, and blood that flowed from his body to the ground, that pooled at the foot of the cross, a blood that cleanses us of our sins, that brings us back and reconciles us to you, that makes us pure and perfect in your sight. We're thankful for that blood, dear Lord. We ask that as we partake of this emblem that represents it, dear Lord, that we do it in a manner that pleases you. For it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. At this time, we have the opportunity to go to God in prayer on behalf of the offering. When the trays are been placed outside the doors as you entered into the building, and we're thankful for your contribution if you were able to do so, and if you haven't been able to do so, those will still be available after service. And if you are still worshiping through virtual means, that you have the opportunity to send your contribution to the P.O. box here at the congregation. Let's go to God in prayer together. Our Heavenly Father, you have blessed us in so many ways that you have given us the means to earn a living for our lives, that we may sustain these physical bodies here on earth, dear Lord. We pray that we are good stewards of the things that you have given us, knowing that they are temporary, knowing that they come from you. They are gifts that you give us charge to use according to your word and according to the way that we should live our lives. We pray, dear Lord, that we have set aside and we have prepared and mindful to give back to your church, that we can continue to further the kingdom in this area, that we can continue to outreach to those around us. Heavenly Father, we pray that our hearts and our minds give in a way that pleases to you, that is out of love and joy. We ask, dear Lord, that you would bless this offering. It's our prayer in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen to the singing. Thank you for singing out. Thank you, Jeremy, for leading us so well this morning. We thank God for you. We thank God for this day, this occasion. We're thankful to you for your presence this morning. We're going to start in Colossians chapter 4. We continue reading what Paul would have to say to the Colossians and to us about prayer. And then we'll move toward Luke chapter 10. If you want to be turning in your New Testaments to that text, that'll be kind of the main text of emphasis in just a moment. Luke chapter 10. The most recent, and it's believed to be the most expensive, discovery of sunken treasure. It began back in 2015 with its discovery off the coast of Colombia, the Caribbean Ocean. It's the Spanish ship, the San Jose. It sunk in 1708. It had retrieved some tax monies, some gold and emeralds and other jewels from the South American colonies, Spanish colonies. Was heading back to Spain to deliver those, to continue to fund their war effort as they were trying to establish their independence and those kind of things. And they met a British ship, and that British ship fired upon them, and apparently it ignited their gunpowder reserves, and the whole ship just went down almost immediately. So 2015, the Colombian Navy had a robot that they were discovering or searching the sea with, and they discovered this wreckage. It took a few months before they ever let on that they had discovered it. As you can imagine, there's been quite a bit of lawsuits and jockeying for who owns the rights to it. Estimates are, they've still not brought it to the surface, but the estimates are that on the low end, the gold, the jewels, are worth $14 billion. Could go as high as $22 billion. I really don't even know how they begin to figure up that amount. But what do? When we realize something valuable or precious is lost. What we do when we realize that something precious and valuable is lost. Last week, after we dismissed from our worship, someone came up and talked quickly about the sermon, and he was talking about the power of those short prayers that we mentioned that Jesus prayed in the garden, and he said he has a friend who every time he loses something, even if it's small, he says a quick prayer to the Lord to help him to find it. And he always finds whatever it is that he's lost and misplaced. Knowing that we would discuss this part of the text this week, that little anecdote just stayed with me in my mind. I can't get rid of it. Just to think how basic, yet how much faith it shows to pray over lost things. Maybe when we find ourselves not praying enough about souls, lost souls, and laborers to reach those souls, maybe we would do well to assess ourselves about how we pray about the smallest of things that are lost. What Paul does here in Colossians 4, in talking about praying, he turns the attention to the most valuable thing God has created. He turns our attention and the Colossians' attention to the soul. So let's read together. Colossians 4, verses 2 through 4. We've been studying verse 2. Let's expand out into the rest of this text. So continue steadfastly in prayer, being watchful in it with thanksgiving. At the same time, pray also for us that God may open to us a door for the word, to declare the mystery of Christ, on account of which I am in prison, that I may make it clear, which is how I ought to speak. So in addition to our lives being defined by praying and praying always, so too our lives ought to be defined by praying for souls and praying for laborers to reach those souls. What we find here is that this masterful letter about Christ, it emphasizes the supremacy of Christ and how Christ holds everything together, and that then changes everything about our lives. As Paul closes this letter, he emphasizes now that it's not all about us. That Christ saves us, reconciles us, and changes our lives so that through us, he can continue to change more lives. Paul orients us to that reality in this text, and then the verses that follow that we'll discuss next week orient us to that reality as well. So So let's look at why this matters in Colossians. Three observations about why Paul would close with this emphasis. Number one, they needed the reminder they were at one time an open door. Epaphras was a preacher and a teacher who came through and discovered that these people did not know the Lord, and he preached them the gospel. Just a simple fact that one time they were an open door, like what Paul is praying for in these verses. How often do we pause and remember and also offer thanksgiving that every single one of us who knows the Lord, who is a Christian, became one in part because people prayed for us to become one. That prayer is instrumental in us obeying the gospel. Therefore, the more we pray, the more we understand that impacts other people coming to know the Lord. Every single Christian was prayed about before they obeyed the gospel of Jesus Christ. But number two, they were themselves experiencing the valuable, the priceless mystery of Christ. Remember, that's what Paul says in his instructions in chapter 4, that he may declare that mystery. Well, they had already begun to experience just how great and precious that mystery is. God chose to make known how great among the Gentiles are the riches of the glory of this mystery, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. You see how when Paul describes the mystery, he cannot help but include a reference to God's glory. Twice there, he talks about its glories and about its riches. The mystery, this thing that was once unknown but has now been fully revealed, that God sent Christ to save not only Jews, but to Jews and Gentiles, the whole world. They were now experiencing that, as many of them were Gentiles themselves. So they knew firsthand what these riches were. So number three, they needed to know that others deserved the same opportunity they had received. Here they were, living in Christ, and through their prayers, others can come to know Christ as well. Chapter 1 and verse 20, the close of this beautiful paragraph about Christ being through all things and in all things and holding all things together. It's so that we would see him as the one qualified to reconcile us. So verse 20, through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, making peace by the blood of his cross. All things. Not just the Colossian church, but all people are deserving of the opportunity to hear the gospel of Jesus Christ. And so when Paul orients them to pray this way for him, he's reminding them what you have and possess that is so precious. Other people can come to know and enjoy those same blessings. But the rest of our time this morning, I want us to notice how what Paul does in instructing the Colossians to pray this way is to fulfill exactly what Jesus taught about this same thing. That Jesus would have some things to say about laborers and reaching others with the good news of the kingdom. So that key instruction is in the opening verses of chapter 10. But before we get into that text, I want us to just backtrack quickly into chapter 9 and to read how that sets us up very capably for chapter 10. So if you're there in Luke 10, just go back one paragraph into the end of chapter 9. As they were going along the road, someone said to him, "I will follow you wherever you go." Jesus said to him, "Foxes have holes, birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head." To another he said, "Follow me." But he said, "Lord, let me first go and bury my father." And Jesus said to him, "Leave the dead to bury their own dead. But as for you, go and proclaim the kingdom of God." Yet another said, "I will follow you, Lord, but let me first say farewell to those at my home." Jesus said to him, "No one puts his hand to the plow and looks back. It's fit for the kingdom of God." Notice first, by way of this passage, that Jesus makes it clear that disciples of his obey a costly message. It's costly to obey it. But we also accept carrying out a costly mission, a challenging, trying mission. You'll notice that this first guy says, I'll go wherever you go. Wow, what a statement. What a promise. What a masterful sense of faith you must have to tell Jesus you'll go wherever you go. But Jesus reminds him, as great as that claim sounds, that's further than you ever intend for it to go. Because Jesus says, you'll know if you follow me, you're not going to have really a place of comfort. You're going to follow me, you're going to struggle at times even more than the animals do for a home. You're going to be out on your own. Jesus reminds them and reminds us, it's a high cost to follow him. Can we say with confidence, as we sing sometimes, anywhere is home? To follow him means that we will have to go beyond our comfort zones. We will never reach a soul, a single soul, without going beyond where we expect. But next observation on this idea. Notice that both of these next two guys, they lead with this statement that says, let me first go and do this. You hear that two times. Guys come up and say to Jesus, I would follow you, but, or I am going to follow you, but let me first go and do this. Oh, how quick we are to exercise that same tendency, aren't we? You know, Jesus, I'll get things right, but let me first take care of this. I'll become a soul winner, but let me first do that. I'll follow you, but let me first. We have a habit of procrastinating, maybe of deciding, you know, we can put this off completely if we just put it off for a little bit. They say, let me first. But Jesus made it clear the phrase must be seek first. Seek ye first his kingdom and his righteousness. But it's two pieces of advice to these guys are incredibly important. Notice the first one. Let me go bury my father. Jesus shifts his attention to say, listen to how costly this is. Instead of being so concerned about the physically dead, you must go reach the spiritually dead while they still live. Instead of being so concerned about your father who has passed, if indeed that's a real situation, there's some speculation as to whether or not he was talking about a real situation. But instead of being so concerned about that, how about you go reach those who are dying in sin? And then the second gentleman who said, let me first do this, he said, let me go say farewell to those at my home. Let me go back home to say goodbye. Jesus reminds him, you need to not look back, not long for them, but instead look forward, face forward for more and more opportunities. So if we put the pieces together of this text, the one who is useful, who is fit for the kingdom, is one who is always looking forward and who is proclaiming the kingdom of God. Proclaiming the kingdom is a key component for following Jesus. And often we are quick to separate those two. Well, I'll be a disciple, or I'll be a churchgoer, I'll be a Christian, but I'm not really going to get into to really evangelizing or teaching or carrying out the mission. But Jesus makes it clear here, to do one is to do the other. Now with that backdrop set, look down into chapter 10. After this, the Lord appointed 72 others and sent them on ahead of him, two by two, into every town and place where he himself was about to go. And he said to them, the harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, pray earnestly to the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest. Go your way. Behold, I am sending you out as lambs in the midst of wolves. Drop down to verse 16. The close of these instructions to these 72, he says, the one who hears you hears me. The one who rejects you rejects me. And the one who rejects me rejects him who sent me. So what do we learn from this? And how do we see this fulfilled in Paul's instructions in Colossians 4? First, notice what Jesus says by way of declarative thought. This is just true. He says, the harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. There are souls who are willing, who are in need, and who are open, accepting. Yet the workers sit back and wait. I'm guessing if I would have heard Jesus say that day, I would have, kind of in a crowd, I would have nodded, yes, you're right, Lord, the harvest is ready, the workers are just few, there's nobody to work. But I'm thinking if I'd heard this kind of one-on-one, or if I had some time to think about it, I might find some recesses of my heart that are not right, that question a little bit this sometimes. Jesus, are you sure? Are you sure the harvest really is plentiful? Because when I look out into the world, I see a lot of sin. A lot of wickedness, a lot of apathy. Even, I see it everywhere I turn. Do we really believe Jesus when he says the harvest is plentiful? Or maybe we go to the other extreme and we think too strongly about his second phrase. Maybe we over-agree with Jesus to the point of missing the point about the laborers being few. We would hear him and we would say, yeah, you are not joking, Lord. There is nobody who's willing to work. The laborers are few. There's no interest. Even among your people, they're so distracted. They just want to fit in. They just are consumed by this and that. There are no workers to work. If we fall into either one of those extremes of thinking, Jesus, I don't know if there really are souls to save. Or if we're so adamant in thinking, well, there's just nobody to work, then we're missing the starting point here for Jesus. Because Jesus is telling us there are souls. There are always souls who are willing. And it is difficult to step out and to reach them. And the answer to the laborers being few is not to beg other people to be laborers. It's not to reach out to them directly as much as to us to decide to be laborers. And to do what Jesus says next, which is to pray for those laborers. But interesting, this idea here that Jesus will say the harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. This is not the only time he's had to try to wake the disciples up to this, to open their eyes that right now these people are the ones you need to keep your eyes on. It's back in chapter 4 of John, and they're in Samaria, that this woman who's at the well, the disciples go to get food for them and for Jesus, and Jesus interacts with this woman, and he's able to tell her all she ever did, and that changes her mind and then changes her life. And John even tells us, when they get back from getting food, they see Jesus talking to her, but they even marvel. They're amazed that he would talk to a woman, a Samaritan woman at that, but they don't bring it up. Well, guess what happens when she leaves, and she leaves to go tell the town about Jesus? They still don't bring it up. They say, hey, Jesus, we got your food. Time to eat. And Jesus has to wake them up and say, stop thinking about the food. It's time to think about souls first. So Jesus would say to them, verse 35 of John 4, do you not say there are 4 months, then comes the harvest? As farmers, you know when harvest season is. You know it like clockwork on the calendar. He corrects them. Look, I tell you, lift up your eyes and see that the fields are white for harvest. What he's saying is you had this soul in front of you, and yet all you could think about was food. There is no season for souls. Souls are, quote, in season year round. And Jesus has to get us to see this before we'll follow through with reaching them and praying for them. Because we have to see that our souls yearning for the gospel, for a God and for a Savior who fills their hearts like nothing else can. So as we assess ourselves here, are we the woman at the well who's reaping, who's going about, who's doing, and who's praying? Or are we more like the disciples in this instance, while we're just waiting for the harvest to come, while Jesus says it's already here? If we find ourselves still waiting on the harvest, we still do not fully understand the harvest. So next, you'll notice in the end of verse 2, Jesus tells us what to do. When we truly understand that there are souls who are willing and who are out there right now, and that there are a shortage of workers, we must pray, and pray earnestly to the Lord of harvest that he will send out workers. You'll notice the emphasis is pray earnestly. It's not the traditional word for praying. It's a highly kind of specific word. Luke loves to use it. He uses it in this gospel account and also in Acts. It's the word that's often translated beg. So the idea is beg the Lord. Beg the Lord of harvest to send laborers. And often you'll find it used in conjunction with a specific request. You don't ever see this word describing the general act of praying. It's begging for something specific to be given. You see Jesus doing just that in this text. Listen to a couple of instances. Luke chapter 5, and verse 12. While he was in one of the cities, there came a man full of leprosy. When he saw Jesus, he fell on his face and begged him, "Lord, if you will, you can make me clean." This man is completely overtaken by this disease that could have been fatal. It certainly did separate him from society and from those he loved. Can you imagine the earnestness, the fervency with which he would have begged for Jesus to make him clean? Luke chapter 8, you've got the man that's possessed by the legion of demons, the area of the Gerasenes. Verse 28 of Luke 8, when the demon's talking through the man here, when he saw Jesus, he cried out and fell down before him, and he said with a loud voice, "What have you to do with me, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? I beg you, do not torment me." You hear that? The demons are begging Jesus, don't mess with us any more than you already have. You go on and keep reading, and they say, "Don't send us into the abyss, to hell early, as it were." They're begging Jesus, "Leave us alone." Begging, same word that Jesus uses here about praying to God for laborers. As the story continues, Jesus sends that legion of demons into the pigs nearby, this massive herd of pigs. Those pigs run off the cliff into the sea, and they drown. As you can imagine, that creates some hysteria, some attention toward Jesus. But because that represented kind of a financial loss, they don't like what happened. They don't like Jesus being among them. So they try to run Jesus out of town. They tell him to leave. So listen to how that continues. Verse 37 of Luke 8. Then all the people of the surrounding country of the Gerasenes asked him to depart from them, for they were seized with great fear. See, it was too costly for them for Jesus to stay among them. So he got into a boat and he returned. But listen to verse 38. The man from whom the demons had gone begged, same word. He begged that he might be with him. You can see why, right? Here I am, I've been so debilitated by this possession, and now you've healed me. I owe you everything. I want to go with you. And so he begs him deeply to go with Jesus from that point forward. Let me follow you. Of course, Jesus tells him otherwise. Jesus sent him away saying, "Return to your home. Declare how much God has done for you." He went away proclaiming throughout the whole city how much Jesus had done for him. So the man begs to be with Jesus. Jesus says, "You go be my spokesperson. You go be this missionary that will tell these people who have rejected me thus far. You tell them how great I am to you." But next, Luke chapter 9. Luke chapter 9, verse 37. On the next day when they had come down from the mountain, a great crowd met him. And behold, a man from the crowd cried out, "Teacher, I beg you to look at my son, for he is my only child." Only child. What's wrong with him? Verse 39. And behold, a spirit seizes him, and he suddenly cries out. It convulses him so that he foams at the mouth and shatters him and will hardly leave him. Can you imagine the desperation on this father's face? Here's my only child, and he's possessed by a demon, and I'm afraid he's going to die every time it takes over. These physical symptoms, no doubt, are scary to read about. So you can imagine the fervency with which he would beg Jesus to heal his son. Listen to verse 40. And I begged, same word, I begged your disciples to cast it out, but they could not. How fervently do we beg? How fervently would we beg for Jesus to heal our son in that situation? Or how fervently do we beg for God to heal our loved ones when they're sick? How fervently do we beg to God when we ourselves are sick? What about the conviction of verse 40? I begged your disciples already, but they could not. Jesus would go on to convict and rebuke those disciples, "You faithless generation." Here we are, knowing that souls are lost. Do we beg? Do we hear their cries, their pleas? They're essentially saying, "Do you see me as a soul? Do you see me as in need of spiritual healing that Jesus gives. So Jesus says, recognize the harvest is plentiful, the laborers are few. So pray fervently, pray earnestly and deeply. He says specifically, pray that the Lord will send out laborers. Notice he directs that prayer. Pray that the Lord of harvest will send out laborers. So the fourth idea this morning is that God is active in his own mission. That's exactly what Paul would have us to pray in Colossians 4. Pray for us that God may open a door for the word. Jesus says, you pray, and you pray that the Lord will send out laborers. Maybe in some sense it may sound like a great deal of trust, a great bold prayer to pray that God will act. But should it? Should it challenge us to say, God, act. God, help. God, influence this situation for good. If we find it kind of being a little unusual or uncomfortable for us to pray that directly to God and about God to act, we might do well to ask ourselves, why are we even praying? Why pray to a God who's not actively involved in his own mission? Why bother to pray at all if we do not view God as the God who acts and creates opportunities for the gospel to go around the world? So maybe a good test on this prayer from Colossians 4, 3 and 4 is to ask, how often do I pray those simple words? Please send laborers out into the harvest. We know we need to do a much better job of reaching souls, growing as soul winners ourselves. But the starting point, according to Jesus, Luke 10, is to pray. To pray earnestly and deeply, but to pray often. To pray regularly. To pray steadfastly for laborers. It would be the peak of hypocrisy if we would keep on praying for laborers while rejecting that opportunity to be laborers ourselves. So there's some great wisdom in this. Start by praying and praying for more laborers, all the while understanding we must keep growing ourselves as laborers. There's also some great wisdom in Luke chapter 10 and verse 16 that we read, where Jesus would say to those disciples, when they hear you, they're hearing me. It's not your message, it's my message. When they reject you, they're rejecting me. And when they reject me, they're rejecting the one who sent me, the Father. I think you see that same perspective in Paul's words in Colossians 4. Remember, it's back there that he said that he is in prison on account of the mystery. And then he says that I may make it clear, that I may make it clear, which is how I ought to speak. Paul goes with this burden. And he says, you know, as these doors open, I want you to pray that I'll have these doors and that I'll declare the mystery, and that when the time arises, that I'll be clear, which is how I ought to speak. Paul never shied away from having a sense of ought and obligation. And here he says, the obligation is that I will speak clearly and plainly. I think what he's getting at there is so that people will know the source of the message. Paul never wanted it to be about Paul. It wasn't just the next thing. It wasn't just the popular thing. It was so that they would know what they're accepting was Christ. What they were rejecting, perhaps, was from God and from Christ, if they chose instead to reject. And so here is this wisdom from Paul. He's praying for these opportunities while already knowing what he will do within the doors when it opens. Also notice Paul's perspective. I love this, that he says, pray for an open door that I can declare this mystery on account of which I'm in prison. It's already cost Paul to declare that not just Jews but Gentiles, that's probably the most costly part of this in the eyes of the Jews. They don't like the Jesus stuff. They don't like the resurrection from the dead stuff. But that really gets them riled up when he says the Gentiles are just as deserving of it. So he's in prison because he's preached this message, and he continues to ask them to pray for him to have more opportunities to keep preaching the same message. So since an imprisoned man is praying for an open door, what about those of us who are free? What should we pray for when it comes to the gospel to spread? What about since we recognize we live in the most technologically advanced era of time? What about when we recognize we enjoy the privileges of a government-protected system of liberties and rights in our nation? How then should we pray? How then should we speak and act? When Paul would say, here I am in prison because of the gospel, so keep praying that I'll have more open doors to keep declaring and declaring plainly that gospel message. As we think about this burden and opportunity to pray for souls, to pray for opportunities, and to be stronger soul winners ourselves, we will do well to just remember this, that every soul has value in the eyes of God. And this line of thinking alerts us to that too. Because every single soul we cross paths with is either a soul to teach about Jesus Christ or is someone who is a fellow laborer in the kingdom. So Paul's praying for open doors to declare the message. So we run across someone who's lost, that's a person we can say. We run across someone who is in the kingdom, we get to latch arms with them and become a fellow laborer, keep working with them to reach souls. Starting point, pray. Pray for souls. Pray for soul winners, laborers in the harvest. This morning, if you are not a Christian, if you don't know the joy of being saved in God and experiencing that mystery, the riches and the treasures that are found in Jesus Christ, choose today to be the day that you do obey Him. Because you believe and trust in Him, you're willing to confess that belief because you know you must repent and change your life through Him, choose to put Him on in baptism where He forgives and where He saves. We'd love to assist you with that today. If you have questions about that, we'd love to address those from the Word of God with you this very day. If you've wandered away from Him, you've not been living in view of those riches, choose today to be the day that you make your life right with Him. If you need to do that in a public way, this time is for you, and we are here for you. Would you come and come now as we sing together?